We discussed some of the component models, the resistors and capacitors. Now we'll say what happens when you make a number of such identical devices on the same chip. Right? Essentially what we'll be talking about is mismatch between like components. So when you fabricate an IC, let's say you make a number of resistors, all the poly layers will be fabricated at the same time and they'll get doped to the same levels and so on. So there is a reasonable expectation that all the components, that is if you make a resistor of identical length and width, a number of them, they'll all have identical resistances. Now it turns out that they'll not be exactly the same because there'll be some random errors in the definition of edges, in the doping and so on, right? So this is what you want to fabricate. Let's say if it's a resistor, this is one side, this is the other side. But in reality, the edges may be a little jagged, okay. Similarly, the thickness may not be uniform throughout the entire area of the resistor. It may be randomly non-uniform. And also the amount of doping two different resistors get, the number of dopants will be slightly different, okay, that is randomly, right. So there will be, if you make a number of these identical devices, they will all nominally have the same value, but they will be slightly different from each other, okay. You fabricate maybe 1,000 resistors, right, of the same length and width and on the same material and so on. And nominally they are supposed to have a resistance or not, okay. So that is, given the exact amount of doping and so on, you can calculate the nominal value of the resistance based on the geometry of the device. If you measure all 1,000 resistors, they will all have different values. They will have 1,000 different values. And if you calculate the mean of those things, it will be R naught by definition, right. So the mean value of the 1,000 resistances will be R naught. But if you plot the distribution, that is the probability density function, it will have a spread around R naught. Okay, and typically just like many other natural processes, this will have a Gaussian distribution, but we don't have to usually worry too much about exactly what it is. It will have a Gaussian distribution, right? And if given that it's a Gaussian distribution, you can characterize it using the mean and the sigma, right? Then you know everything about the distribution. So it will have a certain sigma. I'll call that let's say sigma r. You plot the probability density function of a large number of resistance values which were supposedly identical, you will have the mean to be the nominal value and you will have a distribution around the nominal value. And the standard deviation of the distribution will be some sigma r, okay. So what does this mean? Given that it's a Gaussian, you can also say that 99.9%, 999 out of 1000 resistors will be in the range R naught plus minus 3 sigma, right. Now the actual value of sigma depends on the value of the resistance itself, as we will see very soon, okay. So given this, you can make other estimates of how accurate your circuits will be. For instance, where do you use resistors? Perhaps you use it to make a voltage divider, let's say. You had some reference voltage and you wanted to get half of that. So you will use two resistors, identical resistors. Now they will not be exactly identical, there will be some difference. So the output voltage you get will also not be half the reference voltage, it will be slightly different from that. So given the standard deviation of the resistors, you can estimate how much difference is going to be, right. So this R naught will be something R naught plus delta R1, R naught plus delta R2. Okay. And it's also assumed that when you have a large number of resistors, the errors in each of the resistors will be uncorrelated from others. Okay. The random errors will be uncorrelated. That is delta R1 and delta R2 are uncorrelated. And the standard deviation of this delta R is some sigma R. So given that, you can make an estimate on the uncertainty in this voltage. So that's where the effect of resistance mismatch comes in. For instance, let's say we already saw that we make amplifiers by using a resistive divider around an op-amp. Now if the resistive divider has an error, then the op-amp gain will also have the same error. Okay? If the feedback fraction has a certain error, then the forward gain in closed loop will also have the same error. Okay. That's the effect of resistance mismatch. It will also have an effect on other circuits in which you assume identical components. For instance, when you make a digital to analog converter, you do assume that there is some component which has been replicated so many times. But there will not be identical replicas. That's what it means. Now the next question is, like, what is this sigma? I mean, is it some fixed quantity or is it something that what resistance value you fabricate? What do you think? So let's say you have some nominal resistance R0 and you fabricate a number of resistances R0, each will be somewhat different. Okay. And this also can be expressed as 1 plus delta R by R. Okay. Now this is a dimensionless quantity, you can express it in percent, and normally the sigma of this is what is specified. Okay. The sigma of the relative error in the resistance. I'll call it sigma delta R because I called something else sigma R, but you get the idea. Normally you don't specify the error in ohms, but you specify it as a percentage, percentage of the value of the resistor itself. Now my question is, if I make 1 kilo ohm resistor or if I make 16 kilo ohm resistors, will this percentage error be the same or different? So there is a very clear cut way of calculating it. So let's say we have a particular resistance R0 and another resistance of 2 times R0, right? Now 2 R0 is nothing but 2 R0s in series. Each one will have its own error. Okay? So this will be some R0 plus delta R1. This is R0 plus delta R2. Because the error in every part that is R0 is uncorrelated from each other, right? This a resistance of 2 R0 can be fabricated as, let's say this was the dimension you used for a resistance of R0. Okay. You put two of them in series. The total resistance will be So if this is sigma R, sigma delta R, what is this? What's the standard deviation of this error? So the standard deviation of the numerator is here, the sigma delta R is the deviation is delta R by R0. Okay? So these two are uncorrelated quantities, but you have an extra 2 in the denominator. So the standard deviation of this will be sigma delta R by square root of 2. Is this clear? Okay, this is the actual value of a resistance of nominal resistance of 2 R0. And for nominal resistance of R0, you have this. Let me call the standard deviation of this sigma R. Okay. Then what is the standard deviation of sum of two such quantities when they are uncorrelated? If you have a number of independent identically distributed quantities, you will add the variances. Okay. That is, you add the sigma R squares. So the standard deviation of this part is square root 2 sigma R. Now normally it is specified as a relative error. So in this case, the relative error is delta R by R, which is sigma R by R, and which is what I define as sigma delta R. Okay. And in this particular case, it is delta R1 plus delta R2 divided by 2 R0, which is, R0. Okay. So it is sigma R divided by square root of 2. So it looks like if we make a larger resistance, we will get a smaller relative error. Is that a fair statement? This is again sigma delta R, sorry. Let's make a resistance of R naught by 2. There are various ways of making it, but let's take two resistance of R naught and combine them in parallel. Okay. What will be the relative error in this? The relative error is the standard deviation in the resistance divided by the nominal value of the resistance. What do you think it's going to be in terms of sigma delta R? So sigma delta R is the error in R naught. So what is the relative error in R naught by 2? A nominal value of R naught gives you an actual value of something like this, where the standard deviation of this is sigma delta R. Okay. Now this can be thought of as a conductance of G naught, where G naught is 1 over R naught and some uncertainty in the conductance. Okay. What is delta G by G naught? This by definition is the reciprocal of the resistance, right? And G naught is 1 over R naught. So delta G by G naught is minus delta R by R naught for small values of delta R by R naught. Okay. So if you have two resistances in parallel, you will add the conductances. Okay. So the total uncertainty will be delta G1 by G naught plus delta G2 by G naught in the conductance, or it will be the same thing, delta R1 by R0 plus delta R2 by R0 in the resistance. And the standard deviation of that is sigma delta R by square root of 2. Okay. So it's exactly the same as before. So now it looks like we made half the resistance and got 1 over square root 2 the error. So how do we express the dependence of error on the resistance? Does it depend on the resistance, or what does it depend on? Is there something common between these two? We had one resistance of R naught, the relative error was sigma delta R. Then we made depends on volume. Yeah. And because we don't have any control over the vertical dimension, we for our purposes it depends on the area. Okay. So if this is L and this is W, we made 2 R naught by making 2L and W, and we made R naught by 2 by making 2W and L. Okay. Each of these had the error in this divided by square root of 2. So it really depends on the area. So if the errors are random in each part of the resistor, then over a larger area they do get averaged out. Okay. So that's the general idea. So like I said, it does depend on volume, but we express this as a function of area because that's the only thing we have control over. Okay. So in general, the relative mismatch depends on the area of the resistor. Now I could make this resistance R naught also by using half the width and half the length. Okay. What is the consequence of this? What will be the relative error in this resistance? This is also R naught. I have L by 2 and W by 2. What's the relative error here? Huh? No, 2 times sigma delta R, because both the area has become 1/4, right? I have reduced both the length and width by a factor of 2. So the area has become 1/4. So it is 2 times as bad in terms of mismatch. So you can see that some kind of trade-off already, that if you try to crunch down things into a small area, you will be hit more by mismatch. Okay. Now you can expand it into a large area, then first of all, large area means more expense. Right? In a chip, the area is what counts. You have a wafer, how many chips can you cut out of that wafer is what determines the revenue that you get from one wafer. Okay. What other consequence do you have? Let's say I want to improve mismatch. I want to improve matching. So I make a bigger resistor. That is, I am talking about a physically larger resistor, not a large value of resistance. What's the consequence of that? What are the other consequences? One is area. Parasitic capacitance. Yeah. So now if you try to make a circuit more precise by improving matching, by increasing the area, you will have a larger parasitic capacitance. Okay? So again, there is some trade-off between speed and precision. So if you have more parasitic capacitance, that means that your circuit will not perform very well at higher frequencies. We will see the details later, but you can already imagine that the more capacitance you have, the worse high frequency behavior it has. Okay? So there is some trade-off between precision and speed. So in general, in a given process, for a given type of resistor, this is given as some AR by square root of the area. Okay? So this itself is assumed to be constant. Okay, it's some constant divided by the square root of the area, and it is reasonably valid for most processes. Right? Unless you go to some extremes of length or something, it is generally valid. Now it depends on type of resistor. I mean, there is a particular value of AR for a poly resistor, polysilicon resistor, and something else for a N-well resistor, and so on. For each type of resistor, the kind of uncertainties you get are different. Now, normally as a designer, what you worry about is what you can control, that is W and L. So what you are interested in is just this number AR. So that will let you know which resistance you can use in a certain application. Okay? Because it's going to have a certain amount of mismatch. So you have to use a certain amount of area to fabricate it. Okay? So AR is, the units of AR is in some percent micron. So if you reduce W and L both by a factor of 2, your uncertainty increases by a factor of 2. Okay? Now this is true of, it turns out of all components. The uncertainty turns out to be inversely proportional to the square root of area. And the principle is the same. Over a large area, things get averaged out. I won't show this, but you can easily make the same analogy with capacitors. You put two capacitors in parallel, the errors do get averaged out. So the relative error in the capacitance value is some constant that depends on the process and the type of capacitance divided by square root of WL. And this is again in some percentage times micron. So depending on these things, you make your design choices. Okay. Now here the error we are talking about is random error. There is something known as systematic error which comes about the way you design components. Okay. Here you make two exactly, I mean, seemingly identical components, there will still be some errors between them. This is because of things out of your control, like random processes, like maybe the number of dopants that went into one is slightly different from the other, the edges are not exactly straight, and so on. Okay? It's because of that. So these are random errors, and random errors are inversely proportional to square root of the area. So typically these numbers are of the order of 1 or a fraction of a percent micron. That is, you can get a matching of few percent easily on an integrated circuit, up to maybe like 0.1% or something. But if you try to get a matching of 0.01%, then the area will become very large, okay, unmanageably large. So that limits the precision you can obtain in certain kinds of circuits. Now, these are basically random errors between seemingly identical components. That is, you make 1000 resistors, let's say, they'll have a certain nominal value and certain variance. That's what we are talking about. Now there is another kind of variation that comes about, okay, that is common to all the components. Here we are talking about variations between different components on the same chip. But let's say you try to fabricate 1 kilo ohm resistor and then you make a number of them on the circuit. Now they may have a small variance, but the mean value will not be exactly 1 kilo ohm. This is because you can't adjust the exact amount of doping and thickness and so on. There will be some uncertainty, but here I am not talking about uncertainty that is different for each component. It is common to all components. So if you measure the mean value, it's perhaps 0.8 kilo ohms or 1.2 kilo ohms. So this is known as process variations. When we say process variation, we are talking about differences in the mean value. Let's say you fabricate a chip in TSMC 0.18 micron today, and then maybe 3 months later you fabricate it, and you fabricate the same circuit, the same resistors. The resistors there will be different from the resistors here, okay, by some scale factor, because some condition in the fab may have changed and so on. Okay? So that is known as a process variation. So, for instance, if you try to make resistance of R naught, it may be scaled up by some value. So, it may be plus or minus 20% off from this. So, if you make, let's say, 100 resistors on a chip, all the 100 resistors will be either 20% higher or 20% lower. That's possible. And on top of that, you will have errors between the 100 components. That is given by the random mismatch model. Okay? Is this idea clear? So, let's say you fabricate 1000 resistors today and plot the density function. You will get, perhaps you will get exactly R naught. I don't know what you will get. And then you fabricate it in a different run of the same process. It's nominally identical, but some conditions would have changed. So there will be some it may be skewed 20% higher or it may be skewed 20% lower. Okay. This is what is known as process variation. Okay. And in each process you will have random mismatch. The process variation is a big deal because when you design discrete component circuits, when you buy, let's say, 1 kilo ohm resistor, you can buy a tolerance of 1% and it will always go, it's always going to be 1 kilo ohm plus minus 1%, right? Whereas in case of an IC, you have to make an allowance for this kind of variation. That is, you have to make sure that your circuit achieves the desired function even if all the resistances are off by a certain factor. Okay? There is a certain limit on that factor that is provided by the fabrication foundry. They will tell you that the variation in the possible variation in resistor is maybe plus minus 20%. Possible variation in capacitor is probably again plus minus 20% or so. So there will be models for this. You have to account for that. Okay? On top of it, you have to account for mismatch. In case of a discrete resistance, you can't really say because, see, they are not fabricated identically at the same time. So in that case, it is the process variation plus random mismatch, the whole thing together. Okay. See, in this case also, you can kind of close your eye and say, my resistance goes anywhere between this point and this point, right? But you don't do that because you have some little more information on it. You know that at least when you fabricate it once in a given run, it will be more precise than this. So in case of discrete component, it is both. So it is batch, there will be some batch to batch variation and there will be some intra batch variation. Okay. Sometimes you do use that. Even in discrete components, you use devices from the same batch. It will be better matched than you buy it from a different one. Okay. In case of discrete resistances, it's supposed to be within 1%. So that is, that includes all of the random variation plus batch to batch variation. So this 0.2 R naught, like plus minus 20% error, is not always a result of fabrication error. It can be modeling error and so on. It's a combination of all kinds of errors. You just don't have enough information about it. And to be on the safe side, they tell you that it is within 20% of value they quote. So whenever you simulate a circuit, you also have to simulate it over what are known as process corners. Those of you who have been through digital circuits know what process corners are. There are fast processes and slow processes. The fast and slow refer to how fast a ring oscillator, inverter based ring oscillator will oscillate. So similarly, there are one extreme corner for the resistor and the opposite extreme corner and so on. So which corner is relevant depends on what circuit you are making. Okay. But you will have to simulate over the process corners and make sure that it works satisfactorily over all of them. The bottom line is there are two kinds of errors, process variations, which basically implies a scale factor error in the component, and mismatch, which is really about errors between supposedly identical components on the same chip. So on the same chip, the components can be relatively precisely matched. In fact, you use that a lot in integrated circuit design. Now a little bit more about matching. So this is about how to, we talked about random errors in which even if you make exactly identical devices, you will get some errors and process variations. Now there are some techniques to improve the matching, that is at least get the best matching that is possible, right? Okay. Let's take let's say we are talking about capacitors. Now let's have two capacitors. One of them has, let's say, 10 micron width and 5 micron length. Okay, so the total area is 50 micron square. Another one has 2.5 micron width, length and 20 micron width. The net area is still 50 micron square. Now, the area is the same. So, the random mismatch model tells you that the uncertainty is the same in the two devices. Okay? That is true, but if you make one capacitor like this and another capacitor like this, do you think the matching is going to be good or bad? So, let's say you want to have two identical capacitors. You make one capacitor like this, 50 micron square, another capacitor like this, which is also 50 micron square area. Is it going to match well? You make two different geometries, the environment is going to be different, that is the surroundings. If you take the just the parallel plate component of the capacitance, they will be the same in two cases, and the uncertainty in that will also be the same. But that's not the only part of the capacitance. We saw that along the perimeter you will have fringing field. Okay. So C1 is 50 micron square times the capacitance per unit area plus 30 micron times the capacitance, the fringing capacitance per micron, right, per unit length. So the total perimeter is 30 microns, and C2 is 50 micron square times C area, that part is the same, plus 45 microns times the fringing capacitance. Okay, so the two will be different. This is what is known as a systematic error. Systematic error means you know what the cause is, you can easily avoid it. That's roughly what it is. Okay, it comes about because you have designed the two things differently, and because of the difference, there is a definite error in the component value. Okay, so the fringing capacitance component is different in the two. So if you want two identical capacitors, this is definitely not the way to do it. You make either both of them like this or both of them like this. Okay. Depending on whatever is convenient for layout. So it is important to size your area large enough so that your random mismatch goes down to an acceptable level. But it's also important to avoid systematic errors. Let's say 50 micron was going to give you 0.1% sigma delta C. Okay. Let's say this is what you calculated. But then you make two capacitors like this, then you have such a big systematic error that the whole thing is pointless. Okay. You have to also make sure that you don't have any systematic errors in the way you lay out the component. So this has something to do with the geometry. I am emphasizing this in this class, but this is something you don't see in when you are only simulating circuits, right? This comes about only when you are laying out circuits and so on. So which we don't really do in this class, in this course. But these are the things that you have to keep in mind. So let's say I want an amplifier of gain 3. Okay. So this is what I need. Now the two resistances are of different value, but I do want the ratio of the two resistances to be exactly 2, right? That will give me a feedback amplifier of gain of 3. So how will I make the two resistances? There are various choices again. I can use a given W and L. This is for R0. And I can use the same W and 2 times the length. This will give me 2R0. Or nominally it will give me 2R0. Okay. Or I can use, in the second case I can reduce the width and reduce the length also. Okay. Which one am I going to use? Or do I use something else differently? I mean, different from any of these things. I can also make it, let's say, W by 2 and L. Okay. Should I do things like this, or should I do something entirely different from this? Or it doesn't matter, I can use any of them. I need, basically the bottom line is, I need two resistances. The ratio of the two resistances should be close, as close to 2 as possible. Okay? I can't do anything about random errors. Right? But at least I don't want to be hit by systematic errors. You don't do something like this, because if you make a continuous piece of polysilicon, it turns out that there will be some systematic error in this also, because this W12L, this resistance will give you exactly twice this, only if the current flow is exactly along the length of the resistor. Okay? But that is never the case, because you contact this at some point, one or two points. So the current will always, in a real resistor, if you look at it, there will be a metal contact and the current will spread out, and near the middle of the resistor they will be parallel to the length of the resistor. Okay? So it's assuming that the current is uniform across the cross section of the resistor that you get the formula rho L by A. Okay? If the current is non-uniform, you will not get this. But you don't know exactly how non-uniform it is. You can't model it. It's very difficult. Okay? That depends on the exact geometry of the contact and so on. But again, here I am only interested in making sure that this resistance is twice this. If both of them are off by a certain factor, I don't care. Okay? If instead of getting 1 kilo ohm and 2 kilo ohm, I get 1.01 kilo ohms and 2.02 kilo ohms, that is perfectly fine. Or even 1.1 and 2.2 kilo ohms is also fine. What I don't want is 1.01 kilo ohms and 2.01 kilo ohms. That is not in ratio 2. Okay? So I don't know what the resistance of each piece is in reality. I know that roughly it is something, but I don't know exactly what it is. So to make 2 times the resistance, what I do is I use three identical resistances. They will all be contacted in the same way. Okay. And I use this for R0, and I connect these two in series, and I use this for 2 R0. Okay. So whatever resistance the first one has, the series combination, it's a series combination of 2 of those things. Okay, so it will have 2 times that one. So the systematic error is least when you do something like this. And this is how it should be laid out also. You should not make one resistance of length L and another one of length 2L when you are concerned about matching. Okay. Alternatively, what you could do is, again you use 3 pieces. Okay. This depends on convenience. So you can have 2 in parallel and the other one as it is. So now this is of 2 times the resistance and parallel combination is R0. Okay? So this depends on absolute value of R0, which one you choose. So if the length becomes too big, then you choose 2 of them in series, but if the width becomes too big, you put in parallel and so on. Okay? So it depends a little bit on the convenience. But either one of these will give you very little systematic error. Now, if you examine it carefully, again, there will be some systematic error even in this combination. This is better than the other things we discussed. Okay? But still there is some systematic error, and that is because the middle resistance is surrounded by 2 resistors, whereas this has only 1 neighbor. Okay? Now, the amount of doping it gets, and some of those things are dependent on what is on either side. Okay? And it's actually easier to see in case of a capacitor. So let's say I have a capacitor and a capacitor on one side only. Now there will be some field lines from this metal plate to this one. Okay? And on the other side it's not replicated. Okay? So if something is surrounded by 2 sides, and if something has a neighbor only on one side, they will have slightly different properties. Okay? How do you get around this problem? So, when you are really concerned about matching, you just put some resistors, don't connect them, but it will create a physically identical environment for all resistors that you want to use. Okay? So, I am willing to waste these 2. So I don't have to connect it, or I can ground it or something, but they are not connected to any useful part of the circuit. Okay. So now all of the resistances that I want to use, the three in the middle, will have identical neighbors. So the systematic error is reduced as much as possible. Okay. So these are all the things that you need to do to reduce the systematic error. Now there is one more problem that can occur. For instance, there can be a systematic gradient on the chip. Okay. That is, the thickness of this resistor is, let's say, some T naught. This is some T naught plus delta. This is some T naught plus 2 delta, and so on. So as you go from this side to this side, the thickness of the resistor is increasing. So the resistance value is decreasing. Okay. So let's say this is the case. How will you get around this problem? So if there is a systematic gradient from one side to the other, this will have a certain resistance R naught, let's say. This will have R naught plus delta R. This will have R naught plus 2 delta R. Okay. So what do? I want to get a ratio of 2. So I will use the middle one as my unit resistor, and for getting 2 times the resistance, I connect these two in series. Okay. So now I have R naught plus delta R and 2 R naught plus 2 delta R. Okay. So if you have linear gradients, you can get around it by using this. That's what he was pointing out earlier, that he would like to put the single resistance in the middle. It's for this reason. Okay. Now the linear gradient can be in both dimensions, x and y direction. Okay. So in general, if you make sure that, let's say you have two components. And if they have a common centroid, okay, then the linear gradients will get averaged out. Okay. So for instance, now the centroid of the inner resistor is here, the centroid of the outer resistor is also here. Okay. So the linear gradients will get cancelled out if you do this. In cases where matching is very critical, you do something like this. You have dummy neighbors, as well as you try to arrange all the components that you want matched to have a common centroid. Okay. So the common centroid will get rid of linear gradients in the system. Okay. But what happens is, when you have a large number of components and yet you try to arrange them to have a common centroid, the routing, the connections will become more complicated, because you have to cross over the components and so on. So you have to use it a little bit judiciously. You don't want to make everything common centroid, where the routing becomes very complicated, and because of that you will have to expand the area of the circuit. So finally, let's say I already said that if you want capacitance ratio 1:3, similar to resistors, I make one unit capacitor and perhaps I make 3. In this case, I am not going to use common centroid, but that's okay. Let's assume that that's okay for now. And I use dummy cells also on either side. Okay. This is a dummy and this is a dummy. And I can arrange this array in a number of ways. So this is C and this is 3C. Okay. So this part is clear. When the ratio of components is an integer, I use one unit and I use the appropriate integer number of units for the other component. What do? If I have a ratio like this, for some reason I have to make a ratio of, one possibility is I think of this as, okay, my unit cell is C by 10 and I put 10 units for this and 33 units for that. Okay. You can do this to some extent. Now let's say I have 3.35. What do? Now my unit cell becomes even smaller, but there is a minimum limit on what I can use as a unit cell. I don't want to use something very small, and I don't want to also have to connect like hundreds of units, because again that increases the interconnect area and so on. Okay. So I can do this to some extent, but not too much. If I have a ratio of in the second decimal place, I can't do this. So in that case, I will settle for something little less precise perhaps. I will make C I will make 3C, okay, and I will make a smaller capacitor, which is about 0.35C. But what I'll do is I'll make sure that the area to perimeter ratio is the same for all components. So that way at least I'll make sure that some of the systematic component is reduced. Okay. But a matching of this sort, when you want to have a differently sized component, will be worse than when you have identically sized components. Okay. That you have to live with. But the best I can do is I'll make sure that the area to perimeter ratio, all that is identical. That is, I avoid the systematic errors as much as possible. So sometimes you may have to do this and then settle for a higher percentage of error. Is the concept of mismatch clear? Firstly, there is process variation, which is like a scale factor error common to the entire chip on all components. When I say all components of a given type. So all of the polysilicon resistances may be higher by 15%, all of the metal-metal capacitors can be lower by 20% and so on. Okay, that is common to everything. Now that is something you have to design for in your circuit. And when you make a number of identical components, there will be some random errors over which you have no control, except for control over the standard deviation by increasing the area. Okay, that again something you have to calculate. For a given size, I will get this standard deviation of error, I have to calculate the effect of that. And if that's not good enough, I have to increase the area. But then if the area goes out of control, maybe I have to choose a different circuit technique. Then finally, there is systematic error. That is, I have all these random mismatch models, but then because of non-identical environments and different aspect ratios, I can get errors in component values. That I get rid of by trying to create an identical physical environment for all the components during the layout of the chip. Okay.